This week on Wealth Track, like any global competition, the search for income requires dedication, discipline, analysis, precision, and skill to succeed. Highly rated bond fund manager Thornburg Investment Management's Jason Brady discusses his strategy next on Consuelo Mack Wealth Track.
New York Life, along with Mainstay's family of mutual funds, offers investment and retirement solutions so you can help your clients keep good going.
Additional funding provided by Thornburg Investment Management, Active Management, Flexible Perspective, Rosalind P. Walter, and the Fairholme Foundation.
Hello and welcome to this edition of Wealth Track. I'm Consuelo Mack. Question: what is the one investment that Wall Street prognosticators have been telling us to avoid for years because they are overpriced and thus risky? The answer is bonds. The conventional wisdom has been that interest rates can't possibly remain this low for long, and that sometime soon the Federal Reserve will start a series of rate hikes to get them back to normal levels, whatever they are. Even the Fed has encouraged this assumption. Now, surprisingly, investors have not paid much attention to these warnings. With few exceptions, investors have continued to pour money into bond mutual funds and ETFs since the financial crisis. Now, for the most part, it has been a very good decision. Despite expectations to the contrary, the three-decade-plus bull market in bonds is largely intact. Investors might be getting lower yields, but in the fixed income world, that means prices of bonds go up. Well, this week's guest, Jason Brady, manages several highly rated funds for Thornburg Investment Management, where he was recently named president and CEO, in addition to his duties as head of the firm's global fixed income investment team. He runs multiple portfolios at the firm, including Thornburg Limited Term Income Fund, Strategic Income Fund, and the fixed income portion of the Thornburg Investment Income Builder Fund, where Brian McMahon runs the equity side. Brady is also the author of Income Investing, An Intelligent Approach to Profiting from Bonds, Stocks, and Money Markets. Thornburg is a Wealth Track sponsor, but given Brady's record, we will not hold that against him. I began the interview by asking him, is there any reason to believe the bull market in bonds is coming to an end anytime soon?
I just think it's a question of time horizon, in the sense of, over the long period of time, that 30-year bull market in bonds that you mentioned is also a 30-year bull market in central bank stimulus working. So things slow down GDP-wise, or we have a high unemployment rate, and what do? We lower rates. And now you're at zero, and so the ability to continue to stimulate growth through lower rates is very, very challenged at the moment. In fact, arguably, it's working in reverse. So over a longer period of time, it seems hard to kind of get growth going, which would then raise inflation or raise real rates along with it. In the shorter term, actually, I'm concerned, because I think there's a lot of complacency. We're more or less expecting rates to be zero forever. While they may be low for a long time, while the natural rate of rates could be lower, I think that we don't anticipate even any kind of inflation, any kind of wage inflation or services inflation, which we're actually getting. The only kind of lower inflation we're getting now, or continue to get, is goods inflation. So I actually think there are some things that could pressure us higher in, say, 10-year rates, but I'm not talking about 3.5% or 4%. I'm talking about 2.5% from where we are now, which is kind of 150-something.
Most of Wall Street, and certainly the financial press, has been fixated on the Fed, you know, when they're going to raise rates again. And even if the Federal Reserve does raise rates again soon, they did so last December, we know it's going to be gradual, right? And what difference is it going to really make? Is that the wrong place for us to be focused, as far as the kind of whatever the dangers might be to the bond market at this point?
I think it is. And the reason I think it is less because if the Fed raises once or twice or three times, it doesn't matter, or it does, because clearly the pathway matters somewhat. And Williams came out and said, hey, look, if we raise earlier, we can actually be more gradual with this. We don't want to be put into a place where we're kind of behind the curve and catching up. But the reason I think the fixation is sort of frustrating, frankly, is that it's really not an economic question anymore. Mm-hmm. Even in the stock market, you look at the movements of stocks more recently, it's very significantly multiple movements. In other words, let's say PE movements mm-hmm. versus E movements.
Right.
So earnings aren't really moving, but PEs are moving a lot. And we are focused on how can the Fed give us more stimulus from a money flow standpoint. So in bonds, you're seeing huge flows from outside the United States because the interest rate differentials up until recently were very favorable to going and buying, say, the U.S. 10-year versus the 10-year JGB.
Right, because our rates are much higher and our currency's been going up. And yeah.
Exactly. That has nothing to do with the effectiveness of the instrument itself. So pushing people to do something that in the short term is interesting or effective or not for them in the short term is not really great long-term policy. The scariest comment I have heard is that you don't invest in bonds for income, you invest in them for capital appreciation. And I think people who do that are missing the point of fixed income and just looking to sell it on to, you know, the next buyer, which may or may not be a central bank.
Except, I think that you did say to me in an earlier interview that we have to revise our attitude towards the role that bonds play in our portfolio because they used to be an income-producing vehicle and they also used to provide stability. Mm-hmm. They were a non-correlated asset to mm-hmm. stocks. Now what?
Yeah, I think we've taken away the sort of safe asset. So people are buying bonds they're buying bonds because they've been performed well, right?
Yes.
So, hey, look, if you bought any kind of bond, whether it's high yield because credit's done well or it's a 30-year treasury because interest rates have come down significantly, you've done very well. And generally, you've done better than the stock market, so everybody's excited to go into bonds.
Right.
But the reality is all you're doing is pulling forward return in bonds because if I buy a 10-year treasury at 158 yield and I hold it for 10 years, probably going to get 158. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. This is how this works.
Right, the government's not going to call the bond or whatever. Yeah,
it's not able to, et cetera, and we hope that the U.S. doesn't go bankrupt because we'll talk about other problems then. So we've pushed the return out of that security. In the past, that used to have a very important part of asset allocation,
yes.
which was to say, as you pointed out, steady return, ballast for your portfolio. The trouble is, for when so much of that kind of asset allocation methodology came about, the real yield, so the after inflation return, before tax, but after inflation return of say the 10-year, we'll just kind of use that as the reference instrument, was 4%. If the 10-year treasury paid you 4% after inflation, so depends right. what your measure is, but let's call it, you have a CPI, let's call it 6%.
We'd be thrilled.
You'd buy a lot.
Yes.
Right? So now that's not an option. So now what do you do? Right? So people are buying them not for that return. Right? They're buying it for, hey, this price return, not the income return, the price
right.
return.
Right, it's a total return.
And since you're just borrowing that from the future, you're basically picking up nickels in front of the steamroller, right? You're kind of really pushing on the value of that instrument, the value of the instrument both in itself but in your portfolio as well. Maybe the toughest allocation challenge that I see, asset allocation, just broad portfolio challenge for everybody, is in addition to that building block being no longer 4% real, but 0% real, you are stuck in an environment where the other options are added onto that now 0%, so your total return is lower. And that safety return, actually is giving you more volatility. Mm-hmm. In 2013, we saw rates rise. Stocks around the world generally fall. The U.S. did better. Spreads on corporate bonds rise. In other words, prices fall even more than
right.
treasuries did.
Right.
Suddenly, there was positive correlation between your safe asset, treasuries, and your riskier assets. In other words, they're moving price together.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But our whole asset allocation methodology is that they move in opposite ways.
Yes.
So if now rates are at very, very low levels, i.e. bonds are at very, very high levels, and stocks are at very, very high levels, right? In other words, there's been positive correlation, which has been very beneficial to everybody.
Yes, no matter what you're investing in.
Correct.
Yes.
If the positive correlation continues, but it continues in some potential rising rate element, that's less good, right? Then there's no ballast, there's no safe asset, there's no home base.
What do you do then? And I know you run multiple portfolios. I mentioned them in my introduction to you. But one of the funds that I'm thinking of where you run the fixed income portion is the Thornburg Investment Income Builder Fund. Mm-hmm. And in the last time I looked, you were underweighting the bond portion, correct?
Correct.
Are you still, so what is your strategy? Are you investing in dividend-paying?
Dividend-paying stocks and fixed income. So the idea is to provide income for our clients.
You're doing that for income. That's where you're getting
correct.
Your income, the most income now.
And what dividend-paying stocks do is they incentivize management to be cash flow generators, to be good capital allocators, right? Because it's tough to cut a dividend because it's a shareholder focus, because they don't necessarily have as much money left over to do crazy stuff. In fact, if I give you two companies, they both earn $100.
Mm-hmm.
One pays $50 in dividends and one pays zero. So one invests 50, company A invests 50, company B invests 100.
Mm-hmm.
Which one grows its earnings faster over time? It's defined as earnings per share over the next 10 years. It's the company that actually pays a dividend.
And why is that?
Having talked to a lot of companies, I can tell you that it's really about capital discipline,
mm-hmm.
right? But it's also about business models that compound. And so
right.
they'll invest in a compounding business model as opposed to go do something crazy over here or some waste of money or what have you. So they tend to be good allocators, but they also tend to be business models that are sustainable and compounding. So that gives you better returns over time than not generally.
Right, investing in dividend paying stocks.
Correct.
You're not getting it from
fixed
bonds.
Income. Exactly.
Right.
I'd love to.
Yes.
Actually, so it's great when the environment is such that I can get income from fixed income that provides a real sort of a baseload income, to use sort of utility semantics.
Mm-hmm.
So you just sort
mm-hmm.
of, hey, this is going to plug away and give you income. And then I've got something which inevitably is more volatile in stocks than in bonds, pretty generally. And yet that's going to grow its dividend over time. And so I have this nice balance and nice in itself balanced portfolio, all the while providing income, which people need. So now why do I not hold bonds?
Mm-hmm.
Or not as many? It's about 12% today.
Mm-hmm.
Well,
which is really low.
It's pretty low.
Right, historically?
Our range has been from 46 to 9.
Mm-hmm.
So in general, we're right around 25%, mm-hmm. sort of tends to swing around based on where value is. And if I'm an economic buyer of fixed income, in other words, I'm trying to make money for my clients buying a fixed income, I'm competing with infinite balance sheets controlled by central banks, right? And look, they don't buy maybe a high yield security I might look at, or they don't buy various other things that I might be looking at, but they buy treasuries, which then, as we talked about, kind of cascades through and,
yes.
and ends up significantly affecting valuations. So if that fixed income portion doesn't act as much as ballast, in other words, having that negative correlation, stocks fell a lot, but my bonds held up, right? If that correlation actually is more in sync, then the value of that, even as a portfolio position, is challenging. So look, there are always individual things to do. And in
right.
February, we saw risky fixed income completely fall out of bed, and there were things to look at and pick up, and we did. But in general, you think about, okay, what's the portfolio position? What are we trying to do? Income, for sure. Fixed income, unfortunately, doesn't provide that role.
Right.
In 08 and 09, we were half fixed income, and it was tremendous.
And yet, if you look at dividend paying stocks, they're, for the most part, it's an asset class, they're expensive.
Yes, in the U.S.
In the U.S. And I'm wondering about the sustainability of dividends. There was an article in Wall Street Journal recently that said that S&P 500 companies are paying 38% of their net income out in dividends, which is pretty high. It's certainly higher than it's been
in the U.S.
In the U.S. in recent years. Therefore, so in the U.S., dividend-paying stocks in the U.S. as an asset class, too expensive. Maybe the dividend payout ratios aren't sustainable. What's your take on
too expensive, and they are sustainable. So
they are sustainable.
Well,
okay.
Just because dividend payout ratios in the U.S. are much lower than everywhere else in the world. Now, you could argue that reinvestment is part of the reason why U.S. is dynamic growth, but actually the literature says the opposite, right? The literature says that if you actually pay more of a dividend, then you're making a better capital allocation decision. So, but relative to the rest of the world, I don't think that you're running into trouble with 38%.
Mm-hmm.
Relative to business models, I don't think you're running into trouble with 38%. But expensive. So you look at what at Thornburg we might determine the expensive defensive. So things, staples, consumer staples,
mm-hmm.
would be a great example. you know, U.S. telecom. U.S. telecom has had a great run. And there aren't that many, but large cap U.S. telecom is pretty expensive. Mm-hmm. Very similar business models outside the United States.
Like AT&T.
So AT&T is a great example. Great company, has done a good job, fine, but it's not cheap.
Yes.
Outside the United States, totally different story. Right,
the telecoms outside the U.S.
Correct.
Right.
And
so, for instance, what would be the equivalent?
China Mobile. Mm-hmm. So China Mobile is growing really quickly. I can give you the pluses and minuses of all this stuff. You know, so there's some regulatory challenges that they have. They're very large, and so the regulator's kind of trying to make sure that they're not too dominant. But growing quickly, very well capitalized, not expensive. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, we can say that dividend paying stocks are expensive, and in the U.S., utilities for sure, large cap telecom, yes. Financials, which used to be a big part of the dividend paying landscape in the U.S., totally different story now, right? Now financials aren't what I would term particularly expensive, but their dividend payment ability is much smaller, right?
Right. The banks' regulatory pressure. Absolutely.
I think that could get better because I think some of the thinking around bank profitability is different. But let me give you an example. So in Europe, the regulator has generally been frowning upon telecom companies making money. Okay. Rates for consumers are low. Great. The trouble is investment in the infrastructure is low, which kind of makes sense, right?
Yes.
So
not good for the long-term communications infrastructure for Europe.
Exactly. So the regulator, and look, this doesn't go in a straight line, and okay, what do they allow or not allow, and how much competition, how does this look, and rates, et cetera. But I think the general learning process has been, well, just low rates is not the only thing we're looking for. We're also looking for investment. Because we want to keep up. And telecom infrastructure and communication infrastructure is a clear competitive advantage or disadvantage.
Absolutely.
Like in everything, right? So saying, okay, we won because the rates were low, but you're dialing on a rotary phone, it's maybe not such a big advantage, right?
Is that an opportunity, a potential future opportunity
I think so, right.
Telecom in Europe,
right, for instance. So we own some telecom companies in Europe, and each jurisdiction's a little different, mm-hmm. each situation's a little different, each valuation's a little bit different, but it gives you a flavor for the difference in how telecom can be perceived or how telecom can be valued in various places in the world.
On the debt side, mm-hmm. of these investments, mm-hmm. I mean, you're also running the limited term income, mm-hmm. And the strategic income funds, mm-hmm. which are bond funds.
Yes.
So you have to invest in the bond market whether you like it or not.
It's true.
What are you doing? So where are you finding opportunities when you have to invest in debt markets?
Well, the good news is I'm not slavish to a particular benchmark. So I have, especially in the strategic income fund, I have mm-hmm. a lot of flexibility. The limited term income fund is a high quality portfolio, 65% at an initial investment at A and above, and the whole thing's investment grade. So there I have a little more restrictions. Mm-hmm. But there are still things to do. It's just don't take risk when you're not getting paid to take risk. I mean, it's a pretty simple thing. Even if the 10-year treasury, as an example, goes from 150s to 50s, mm-hmm. right, basis mm-hmm. points, mm-hmm. my scope for appreciation is pretty small, right? And I'm
is
not...
Is it?
Well, it's 9%, uh-huh. right, which is more or less the return's been thus far.
Yeah.
But it's 9%.
That's pretty good.
It's good, but it's good... That spread that over 10 years, uh-huh. right? Now I can buy it and then sell it to some other person who thinks that it's going to go from 50 basis points to negative 50 basis points, right? But now we're starting to talk about a greater fool theory of investing, mm-hmm. and these aren't stocks with a potentially infinite upside. This is a bond that kind of can't go very far, already is negative in yield.
But how many times have you actually held a 10-year treasury to maturity?
I actually try to hold.
I
really try to hold things that I'm buying to maturity in general.
You do.
Now,
therefore, how far out do you go? I mean, are you
right? So the limited term income fund goes out to 10 years, but the turnover on that portfolio is in the mid to high teens in general. Mm-hmm. So we're actually kind of holding stuff for a pretty long time, on average, obviously more than 5 years. When I invest in something, I don't want to have to sell it to somebody else who I think is dumber than me to make money. Now,
but you wouldn't be averse to that, right?
Because I wouldn't.
Because that's the way it kind of works. It's a zero-sum game.
It doesn't work that way in bonds.
Oh, it doesn't. Interesting.
Well, because at the end it matures and I get my money back.
You get your money back.
I don't have to
sell
it, right?
Right.
Now, if I don't like owning it to maturity, right, I got to find somebody else who does. If on purchase, I don't like it, but I'm just hoping that somebody else buys it. Mm-hmm. Like, I think that's trouble.
All right, so it's harder in the bond land.
Now, that said, there are things to do. I mean, there are things even in the high quality space to do. I think the money market reform that's happening right now is really shaking up the market, certainly in the front end. And if you can navigate that, I think there's some pretty nice things that you can do to sort of
keep those of us not familiar with the reforms that are occurring in the money market, what should we be looking for? Because most of us have been avoiding money markets because we can't get any yield in money markets.
And now,
of October 14th, is there a big change that's going to occur?
So the change that's happening is that despite the fact that the biggest money market failure of the last cycle was actually a government bond portfolio, what the regulation is that government bond portfolios are allowed to keep that stable $1 NAV, which has always been a fiction, but because volatility has been so low, okay, it kind
yes.
of works out.
And so it never broke the buck was the whole promise of money market funds.
Correct. And right. So the regulators are kind of looking at this saying, this is kind of a bad fiction, unless you're buying stuff that's very, very safe. Now, if you buy mostly stuff that's very safe, but a few things that are not safe, which is what happened in the last cycle, then you break the buck anyway. Mm-hmm. But in any event, if you're a money market fund and you want to buy government bonds, have at it, you're allowed to have a $1 stable NAV. If you're going to buy anything else or significant amounts of anything else, then you have to float your NAV. Mm-hmm. Now, lots of people don't like that because...
Your net asset value, right.
Yes. So people don't like that, right? People want to have a stable NAV.
Yes.
And some other regulations and legal strictures, people have to have a stable NAV. So a lot of money in money market land is moving towards government bonds. So the short end of the treasury market is very, very low in yield.
Right.
At the same time, the London Interbank Offered Rate, the LIBOR rate, a floating three-month rate that has been controversial recently, but generally is a benchmark around bank lending to bank interbank lending, has risen a lot.
It's still under 1%, but it's a lot higher than, right.
And if I'm going to buy a very high quality corporate bond that's floating, it's maybe 1 year long, a U.S. utility, which despite my distaste for the stock valuation, it's a pretty stable business model for 1 year, right? I can get that at greater than 1%. I'm approximating the five-year treasury yield for 1 year that doesn't have any duration risk that floats. Why? Because the regulations have pushed people out of those assets. So if I'm the minor amount of incremental risk that I'm taking to go from treasuries, short-term treasuries to short-term high-quality corporates, and actually the risk I'm actually giving up in going from fixed rate to floating as far as not making sure I'm not really exposed to big moves in rates, these are all short, it doesn't really matter. But I'm actually getting paid a lot for that. Mm-hmm. Now, this isn't a 1% return or a little over 1% return is not going to, you know, make your retirement. You're not going to suddenly be able to retire to Hawaii when before you were going to Ronkonkoma. But
right.
But still, that's
it's better.
And it's I'm
and it,
as
it's
I said,
cumulative.
Don't take risk you're not getting paid to take.
Yes.
If I'm taking a small amount of incremental risk and I'm getting paid a fair amount for it, okay. Like these are the small wins that I have.
Yes.
But it. That's important.
Mm-hmm. As we wrap up this interview, we always ask our guests for the one investment that we should all own in a long-term diversified portfolio. Mm-hmm. What would it be?
Sure. I think U.S. investors tend to be very focused on what they can see and touch right around them. So they tend to be focused, just like everyone in every market, tends to be very kind of home biased.
Right.
And more recently, that has been a very high-performing market. So the S&P 500 has been one of the best-performing asset classes you could buy over the last several years. So it's important, I think, to keep in mind that there are other things to do, other places to invest, thinking about international investment, and specifically thinking about dividend investment outside the U.S. I think the compounding returns piece is important, the quality of the business model is important, and I think that the valuations there are pretty interesting. So I think that really serves people over a very long period of time, which is the kind of time horizon lots of folks are going to need to have. I mean, even if you're retiring in 3 or 4 or 5 years, one hopes that you're going to live for a whole lot longer than that. Mm-hmm. And you know, it's a lot of people said it's not really a finish line. So you got to think about participating in global growth over a really long period of time, but perhaps getting some income along the way and some compounding from both the business model and the return.
So dividend paying foreign-based companies?
Correct, exactly. But dividend paying stocks outside the United States.
All right. Terrific. Jason Brady, thank you so much for being with us for the first time on Wealth Track.
It's a pleasure.
Appreciate it. At the close of every Wealth Track, we try to give you one suggestion to help you build and protect your wealth over the long term. This week's action point is don't give up on bonds. U.S. and global growth is slow, the recovery from the financial crisis is long in the tooth, and there are enough potential geopolitical problems to keep a lid on irrational economic exuberance. Good quality bonds chosen by proven professionals still have a place in portfolios. Well, next week, backed by popular demand, we will sit down with Robert Kessler to discuss his specialty, the most vilified securities in the bond world, U.S. Treasuries. Why is he even more adamant about owning treasuries and cash at this point? We will find out. To hear more of our interview with Jason Brady and why being an English literature major in college has helped his investment career, go to the extra feature on our website, wealthtrack.com. Also, feel free to reach out to us on Facebook and Twitter. Thanks for watching. Have a great weekend and make the week ahead a profitable and a productive one.
New York Life, along with Mainstay's family of mutual funds, offers investment and retirement solutions so you can help your clients keep good going.
Additional funding provided by Thornburg Investment Management, Active Management, Flexible Perspective, Rosalind P. Walter, and the Fairholme Foundation.